In the first lecture on tensor analysis, we have seen a brief introduction regarding the tensor analysis. Now today we will see some of the basic fundamentals of tensor analysis, so that whenever you will discuss the detailed theory of tensor analysis, you feel ease. So in this lecture, we are not going to discuss any rigorous theory on tensor analysis, but we will see some of the important basic fundamentals, and these fundamentals are actually essential to develop the tensor theory in advanced form. So let us start first of all to know the notation of a tensor. In fact, you know, in broad sense, tensors are of two types. And when you say tensors are of two types, it means that tensor components are of two types. Sorry, not two types, but three types. And these are what? These are contravariant tensor, or you can say contravariant component of tensors. The another is covariant tensor or covariant components of tensors. And the third one is mixed tensor or mixed components of tensor. In fact, to make the tensor analysis compact, a number of indices, which may be superscript or subscript or both, is used to make the mathematical development of tensor analysis compact. In fact, superscripts are also known as contravariant indices. So if you want to denote a contravariant component of tensor, then you must write the superscript to symbolize it. For example, if you write here, let us see here, Tij, where I and J, and so I have written here, so on, these indices may be other things or two. Then this actually represents a contravariant component of a tensor. Similarly, the subscripts are known as covariant indices, and so the covariant component of a tensor is denoted by subscripts. When you write Tij and Ij are actually in the subscript, then this symbol actually represents covariant components of a tensor. On the other hand, if the tensor is a mixed tensor, then both the superscript and subscripts are used to denote such a tensor. So you can see, if you write Tij as superscript and Lmn as subscript, then this symbol is for a mixed tensor. So in this way, you can see, in brief, you can say that a contravariant component of a tensor is denoted by a superscript, covariant components are denoted by subscripts, and mixed tensors are denoted by both superscript and subscript. So this is all about the notation of the tensor. Now we will see the rank and number of components of a tensor. When you say rank or order of a tensor, what does it mean? In fact, the rank or order of a tensor is the number of indices in the symbol representing a tensor or components of a tensor, without counting an index which appears once as a subscript and once as a superscript. Actually, this definition will be clear by these examples. Then we will again explain what in this definition has been said about the rank of a tensor. You can see the symbol A. Here in this symbol A, there is neither a superscript nor a subscript. So in this condition, we say that this symbol A represents a tensor of zero rank or zero order. And a tensor of zero rank or zero order is also known as a scalar. And at the same time, if let us write a symbol A, I, I. Here you can see I is once as a superscript and once as a subscript. In fact, this is also a tensor of rank 0. This also represents a tensor of rank 0 because according to definition, if an index is once as a superscript and once as a subscript, then we do not count that index as the rank of a tensor. So here, although there is I as superscript and same I as subscript, so its rank is 0. So a zero rank tensor may be either represented without use of any superscript or subscript, or it may be represented as same index as superscript and subscript. Or you may also say, let us say there is a symbol aij. Here I and j are superscript, and again ai and j are subscript. Then this symbol also represents a scalar, a tensor of zero rank, because you since here I and j come both as superscript and subscript, so we will not count it. So now I hope you have you can understand this definition, that whenever you have to find the rank or order of a tensor, you must count the number of indices either as a superscript or a subscript. But if the same index is in the superscript and subscript, then we do not count it as a rank. So a zero rank tensor may be denoted by the symbol A, or you can also denote it by AII or AIJIJ. So I hope you have understand the definition or what is the rank or order of a tensor, and now it is clear to you. Now see the another symbol here, BI, where I is a superscript. You have seen that a superscript is also called a contravariant indices, and since here there is only one index, so this one index represents the rank of the tensor, and so this is a tensor of rank 1. And since it is a superscript, so it represents a contravariant tensor of rank 1. And you know, a tensor of rank 1 is also known as a vector. So this BI represents a contravariant vector. Similarly, if you write the symbol CJ, but J you can see here is in the subscript. And you know, a subscript is also called a covariant indices. And see this CJ will represent a covariant tensor or covariant component of a tensor. And since the number of index is only 1, so it is a covariant tensor of rank 1. And rank 1 tensor is also called vector. So you may call this tensor CJ as a covariant vector. Now see this symbol DIJ. Here I and J both are subscripts, and subscripts are covariant indices. So this represents a covariant tensor of rank 2. Since the independent indices are 2, so it will represent a tensor of rank 2. And since the indices are subscripts, so this represents covariant tensor of rank 2, and this is also called dyadic. And if you will write now, let us say EIJ. Here IJ are actually the superscript. Then it will represent what? It will represent the contravariant tensor of rank 2, and this will be also known as dyadic. Now let us consider a mixed tensor. You can see this symbol TIJJKL. Here actually there are some indices as a superscript and some indices as subscript. So this symbol actually represents a mixed tensor. Now if you want to find the rank of this tensor, what will be the rank? See here, the index j वंस कम एज ए सुपर स्क्रिप्ट एंड अगेन इट कम्स एज ए सब स्क्रिप्ट एंड अकॉर्डिंग टू द डेफिनेशन ऑफ रैंक ऑफ ए टेंसर यू हैव सीन दैट इफ एन इंडेक्स कम्स वंस एज ए सुपर स्क्रिप्ट एंड वंस एज ए सब स्क्रिप्ट वी डू नॉट काउंट दैट इंडेक्स टू डिटरमिन द रैंक. So actually, the rank of this mixed tensor will be 3, not 5. All the total number of index you can see here is 5. But since J comes once as a superscript and once as a subscript, so we will not count it. So actually, this symbol represents a mixed tensor of rank 3. These indices I, K, L and L determine its rank. J is common both in subscript and superscript, so this will be not counted. So this, now I hope you have understand how the rank, how the symbol of a tensor represents the rank of a tensor. Now actually, what will be the number of components of a tensor in a space? That is that depends actually on two factors. First one is the rank of the tensor, and second one is the dimension of the space. So for a given rank of a tensor, the number of components in different spaces, when you say different spaces, it means spaces of different dimensions will be different. So how it is different, you can see here that if you consider that R is the rank of a tensor and n is the number of dimensions of the space in which you want to find the components of a tensor, then actually the number of components of this tensor, capital N, this capital N represents the number of components, that is equal to n raised to the power r. Let us illustrate this fact by some of the important examples, then it will be clear to you. Let us consider that we consider a three-dimensional space. Actually, three-dimensional space, you know, is an ordinary space. It is also called Euclidean space. So consider a 3D space. And you know this 3D space is also called Euclidean space. Euclidean space. So if you consider 3D space, then the dimension of the space N is fixed. This is equal to 3. Dimension of a space, we have considered 3 and it is fixed. Now we will consider different type of tensors. Let us first of all consider a scalar. You know, a scalar is a tensor of zero rank. So for a scalars, what will be the rank? Rank will be zero. And therefore, the number of components of a scalar in 3D space will be what? You have denoted the number of components by the symbol capital N. So this capital N will be equal to 3 raised to the power 0. See this formula, N raised to the power R. So this is 3 raised to the power 0 and that will be 1. It means the number of components of a scalar in 3D space is equal to 1. In fact, the number of components of a scalar in any space will be 1. Because its rank is 0, so it does not matter that its number of components of a scalar is 1 in 3D space, but it may be 0 in a space of any dimension. When you will actually in general put the power 0 on n, n may be anything, then you will get 1. So a scalar has only one component in any dimension of a space. Now let us consider that our tensor is a vector. If you are talking about a vector, you know Vectors are nothing. These are simply the tensors of rank 1. So for vector r is equal to 1, and we have considered that our space is 3-dimensional. So in this condition, the number of components of a vector in 3D space, this will be equal to 3 to the power 1, and that will be equal to 3. So a vector has 3 components in 3-dimensional space. Now we consider a tensor of rank 2, which is called dyadic. In case of dyadic, you know, these are tensors of rank 2. So what will be the number of components in 3D space? This will be 3 raised to the power 2, that will be 9. You have seen in the first lecture that the number of components of the electrical conductivity tensor sigma, this sigma has actually 9 components in 3D space, and you have denoted those 9 components in matrix form as sigma 1 1, sigma 1 2, sigma 1 3, sigma 2 1, sigma 2 2, sigma 2 3, sigma 3 1, sigma 3 2, sigma 3 3. You have denoted. And similarly, you will see in the course of your classical mechanics inertia tensor. Inertia tensor is also a dyadic, and it has 9 components in 3D space. Actually, in a study of physics, you will find at several places tensor of rank 2, and those tensors will have 9 components in 3D space. But if you consider that our space is in fact not 3-dimensional but 4-dimensional, so if a space is 4D, then in case of vectors, what will be the number of components of vectors in 4D space? As now you can see, the space is 4-dimensional, so the number of components will be 4 to the power 1, because tensors are vectors are tensors of rank 1. So there will be 4 components of a vector in 4D space. Actually, these are known as 4 vector, and we have studied 4 vector in electrodynamics, particularly in the covariant formulation of electrodynamics. And now if we will talk about the components of a tensor of rank 2 in 4D space, what will be the number of components? So for dyadic, the number of components in 4D space will be 4 raised to the power 2, that will be 16. In fact, in the covariant formulation of electrodynamics, we study a particular tensor that is called the electromagnetic field tensor. Electromagnetic field tensor. And you can see that this electromagnetic field tensor is a tensor of second rank, and in 4-dimensional space, it has 16 components. When we will find its component in 3D space, that will be 9. But in 4D space, its component will be 16. So actually, the number of component of a tensor depends on 2 factors. First one is rank of the tensor, and second is the dimension of a space. And so using this general formula, you can easily say what will be the number of components of a tensor in a given space. So I hope you have understand how we can find the total number of components of a tensor in a given space. Now we will see the another important basic fundamental regarding the tensor analysis, and this is about coordinate transformation. Actually, in the course of tensor analysis, we always need coordinate transformation. And for this, let us consider there are two coordinate systems. First one we symbolize by the symbol S, and the another by the symbol S prime. These are actually the two coordinate systems, or you can say there are two reference frames. First one is S and another is S prime. And let us consider that these coordinate systems are actually n-dimensional. It means we consider that our space is n-dimensional space. So if you will specify the coordinates of a point P, let us say in frame S, then there will be n coordinates of this point in frame S, and let us say these coordinates are denoted by the symbol x1, x2, x3, so on, xn. And similarly, if we define the coordinates of the same point P in another coordinate system, let us say S prime, then these coordinates of the same point are x prime 1, x prime 2, x prime 3, so on, x prime n. It means the coordinates of the same point P in the two coordinate system are x1, x2, x3, so on, xn, and x1 prime, x2 prime, x3 prime, so on, xn prime. Now you know these coordinates are actually independent variables, independent from one another. So the coordinates x1 is independent of the other coordinates x2, x3 and xn of the same coordinate system. Similarly, x1 prime is independent of x2 prime, x3 prime, so on, xn prime. But coordinates of a point in a particular coordinate system depend linearly on the coordinates of the same point in another coordinate system. It means you can say that the coordinates of the point P in frame S depends on the coordinates of the point P in frame S prime, and vice versa. It means the coordinates of point P in frame S prime, that is x1 prime, x2 prime, x3 prime, these coordinates will depend linearly on the coordinates x1, x2, x3, so on, xn. And if we know the coordinates of this particular point P in a particular frame, we can easily find the coordinates of the same point in another coordinate system by a transformation equation, and that is called actually coordinate transformation equation. So how we can express this coordinate transformation equation, you can see. So as I have told you that this x1 will not depend on x2, x3 and xn, but that will depend on x1 prime, x2 prime, x3 prime and so on. So you can express these x1 prime, x2 prime, x3 prime as a function of x1, x2, x3. So first set of transformation equation, you can write that x prime 1 may be expressed as phi 1 x1 x2 x3, so on, xn. Similarly, x prime 2 is equal to phi 2 of x1, x2, x3, so on xn. And in this way, since the space is n-dimensional, there are n coordinates of the point, so you can write x prime n is equal to phi n x1, x2, x3, so on xn. Or in brief, you can write these transformation equations in this way. Let us say x prime mu is equal to phi mu x1, x2, x3, so on xn. You can write. Actually, here the index mu is equal to 1, 2, 3, so on up to n. Actually, in this equation, these phi are actually a continuous single valued differentiable function of coordinates. These phi or mu are what? These are single valued continuous differentiable function of coordinates. Actually, this equation 1 is known as coordinate transformation equation. You can see, if you know the coordinates of point P in frame S or coordinate system S, that is x1, x2, x3 and so on, xn are known, then you can find what will be the coordinates of the same point in another coordinate system S prime. So, this equation 1 enable us to find the coordinates of a point P in reference frame S prime when we know the coordinates of the same point in a frame S. So this equation 1 is known as coordinate transformation equation. In fact, its converse is also true. If you know the coordinates of the point P in frame S prime, it means x1 prime, x prime 2, x prime 3 and so on are known, then we can find the coordinates of the same point x1, x2, x3 in frame S. We can easily find by the coordinate transformation equation. Similarly, you can say I am writing direct this transformation in brief. You can write xi equal to psi prime I x1 x prime 1 x prime 2 x prime 3 so on x prime n. Say this is your equation 2. You can see this equation is also a coordinate transformation equation, but here this equation says that if we know the coordinates of the point P in frame S prime, that is x prime 1, x prime 2, x prime 3 and so on x prime n are known, then we can find the coordinates of the same point in frame S. So this equation is also known as coordinate transformation equation. And here this psi prime I are also the continuous single value differentiable function. This is a continuous single valued valued differentiable function. Now, on the basis of these equations 1 and 2, which actually define the coordinate transformation equation, we can also find the differentials which will be transformed. So, the small change in x, how the small change in x will be transformed from one coordinate system to another, it is possible to find on the basis of this equation 1. This is your equation 1 or the equation 2. So, it is possible. So, transformation of differential of x, how the differential of x get transformed. Let us see the equation number 1. From equation 1, you can see according to equation 1, this x prime mu is equal to what? This is actually a function. You can also write it like this, x prime of mu x1, x2, x3 and so on xn. Here you can see instead of this phi mu, actually I have written here x prime of mu, because this x prime of mu is a function of this. So instead of phi you can write x prime of mu. Now you can see that this x prime of mu is actually a function of n independent variables, x1, x2, x3, so on xn. So, if you want to find the differential of this x prime mu, you must follow the rule of partial differentiation. You know it. So, from this equation, we can write dx prime mu. What will be this? This will be del x prime mu by del x1 dx1. Plus del x prime mu by del x2 dx2 and plus so on, plus del x prime mu by del xn dxn. And in compact form, you may write the RHS of this equation by the use of sign of summation like this, I1 to n del x prime mu by del xi dxi. Actually, this equation represents the transformation of the differential of the coordinates. So, here you can see that this mu is equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on. So, in this way, you can transform the differential of a coordinate. Now, we will see a very important another basic fundamental, which is actually called Einstein's summation convention. This is a very important concept which is invariably used in discussing the tensor theory everywhere. So, Einstein's summation convention. समेशन कन्वेंशन। इनफैक्ट अकॉर्डिंग टू आइंस्टाइन समेशन कन्वेंशन, इफ एनी इंडेक्स इज रिपीटेड इन ए टर्म देन समेशन इज विथ रेस्पेक्ट टू दैट इंडेक्स ओवर द रेंज 1, 2, 3 सो ऑन एन। सो दिस कन्वेंशन इज एक्चुअली नोन एज आइंस्टाइन समेशन कन्वेंशन, एंड अकॉर्डिंग टू दिस कन्वेंशन देर इज नो नीड टू राइट द साइन ऑफ समेशन, एंड वी सिंपली सी दैट विच इंडेक्स इज रिपीटेड एंड वी अंडरस्टैंड दैट द समेशन इज इम्प्लाइड विथ रेस्पेक्ट टू दैट। फॉर एग्जाम्पल लेट अस सी दिस इक्वेशन नंबर 3। इक्वेशन 3 यू कैन सी दिस इज डी एक्स प्राइम म्यू इज इक्वल टू समेशन आई 1 to n डेल एक्स प्राइम म्यू बाय डेल एक्स आई डी एक्स आई। यू कैन सी हियर हियर आई इज द इंडेक्स विच इज रिपीटेड, आई इज रिपीटेड, सो डेफिनेटली दिस समेशन इज इम्प्लाइड विथ रेस्पेक्ट टू आई। So according to Einstein's summation convention, there is no need to write this sign of summation, which the index which will be repeated, we will understand mentally that summation is implied for that. So instead of writing this expression by the use of sign of summation, we simply write dx prime mu is equal to डेल एक्स प्राइम म्यू बाय डेल एक्स आई डी एक्स आई। देर इज नो नीड टू राइट दिस साइन ऑफ समेशन सिंस आई इज द रिपीटिंग इंडेक्स, सो इट इज अंडरस्टूड दैट देर इज समेशन हियर। वेन एवर वी विल एक्सपेंड इट, वी विल पुट द डिफरेंट वैल्यूज ऑफ आई फ्रॉम 1 to n। So you can write this simply as this will be del x prime mu by del x 1 dx 1 plus del x prime mu by del x 2 dx 2 and so on plus del x prime mu by del x n dx n. So it is understood that the index which gets repeated, summation is implied for that. So there is no need to write the sign of summation. This is actually known as Einstein's summation convention. So these are the some of the basic fundamentals. And actually in the next lecture on this, we will again see some of the basic fundamentals. And after that, we will see the proper theory of tensor analysis.